We're here at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb with Nick from Faraday Future. Now, one of the emerging technologies that we are very aware of these days is the progress with electric vehicles, and Faraday Future have got one of their beta vehicles here for testing at Pikes Peak Hill Climb. And we just wanted to take some time to get some of the details about this vehicle from Nick. So first of all, Nick, electric vehicles, we are seeing more and more prominence of electric vehicles. Fair to say that it is the future. Do you think that internal combustion engines' days are numbered?
They're numbered. There may be some versions of internal combustion engines that will see a future. There are sustainable fuels. There are biofuels that will still be used, I'm sure, into the future. But electric vehicles will take a much bigger part of mobility as we move forward in time.
Now, before we get into the actual car, while we are seeing electric vehicles become more prominent, as I've mentioned, there is a little bit of controversy in the industry in general about exactly how clean electric vehicles are. Obviously, they're not burning fossil fuels, so that's an advantage. But of course, the electricity powering them has to come from somewhere. A lot of the power generation in places around the world is still coming from dirty sources, such as coal-burning power plants. And then there is also those commenting about the mining for the materials that go into the batteries. I'd love to hear your take on that.
Whilst that's partially true, yes, there are countries, there are places where the electricity produced that goes into the cars is, for want of a better term, is dirty. We've got to look longer term at the long-term future and be saying, if we look at the universe as a whole, what are the most sustainable long-term sources of energy? It is light, sunlight, and it is gravity. And those two forms of sources of energy actually are able to produce all sorts of energy here on Earth. We've got tidal energy, which is from gravity. We've got wind power, which is from sunlight. It's different temperatures in different areas create wind. That's sustainable. We've got direct solar energy. We've got many forms of producing energy in a sustainable way moving forwards into the future. And so electricity is the viable source of power for the future, and therefore as we're developing the vehicles ready for that time.
So essentially what I'm taking from this, and this has been my thoughts on the whole matter, is that right now, yes, potentially there are some places where electric vehicles may not be 100% clean, but we're looking more long term. Yep. And as countries embrace cleaner energy sources, the electric vehicle is obviously going to be the way forward with a low emissions, low carbon footprint.
Yep. Absolutely, that's the way we see it, and that's why, although we're solving the problems of the electric vehicles, we also encourage and are supporting people that are looking at things like solar energy production, tidal energy, wind power. There's all sorts of ways of getting that power, and we support those people and want to embrace those technologies to make eventually a much cleaner, more sustainable future.
Okay, so now let's get on to the vehicle now that we've got that out of the way. And I'm going to be completely honest here. While I know I see engines inside and out, that's been my sole occupation for the last 15 years, electric vehicles are a little bit unique, so I'm definitely not professing to be an expert. I do, however, recall a little bit from my youth when I was playing around with radio-controlled cars, as many people would. So is the technology still similar to what we saw with radio-controlled cars with electric motors?
Yeah, in some ways, it's exactly the same. What you had in your RC car when you were younger is what we've got in our car, but in a much bigger form. But I bet you only had one motor in your RC car. In our car we have currently three motors, but we could have two motors or just a single motor. And it's the adaptability that we build into the car to have different levels of power by designing one really clean, really efficient electric motor. We can have different power levels by putting different numbers of those into the vehicle. We look at an IC situation where we have to maybe start off with a 2-litre turbocharged engine producing 200-ish horsepower. If we want to have 400, we have to throw all that technology away, all that learning away. We have to start again. We have to develop a V6 engine and maybe supercharge it. And if we want even more power because we want to get up Pikes Peak really quickly, then we go and have to throw all that technology away and develop a V8 engine, and maybe we even turbocharge or supercharge that. And it's so much development, so much cost, so much wasted effort in doing these jobs multiple times. We've designed one really dynamic, really efficient motor that we can just put once, twice, three times, or should we be crazy at some point in the future, we could even put four of them in the car, and each of our motors produces around 350 horsepower. So the car we have here today is over 1,000 horsepower.
I'm just interested to delve into that because the concept of multiple engines from an IC background is obviously not usual. So how are those three engines incorporated in your beta Faraday car?
Right, well, we have two motors in the back and one in the front. And why conventionally, if you looked at an IC car, there have been people that have tried putting dual motor cars, a motor in the front and a motor in the rear. But the controlling of two IC engines to perfectly harmonize together to deliver power at the right moments at the right time together, even with modern fuel injection, it's still difficult. Whereas with an electric motor, that control is so easy, so precise, and the reason we've got two at the back is they're completely independent. We don't need a differential. The differential on the back of our car is purely electronic, it's purely software. So deciding how much power, what speed to run each motor at, it's electronic, it's software, and it can be controlled in microseconds, not in rather clunky, quirky, mechanical ways that don't give that fine level of control.
So just to break that down, I'm assuming from that you've got simply one motor powering one rear wheel and another motor powering the other rear wheel?
That's absolutely right, yes.
So no need for a limited slip differential. Now that brings me on to another concept. There is obviously traction control. When you're trying to put over 1,000 horsepower to the ground, traction is obviously going to be some kind of an issue. Now, I also understand your car runs 0 to 60 mile an hour in a pretty impressive time. What's it do?
We've got times of 2.39, so you know, under 2.5 seconds for any car is tremendous, and we're reasonably well under that, and there's more to come. We've got even more developments going on that are bringing those times down even more.
Now, while the car currently isn't in production for any car, that is a very impressive number. Let's just touch on that traction control. Obviously, traction control in an IC application is nothing new, yep. But there are some challenges with reducing the engine torque quickly and getting really good control over that engine torque. How does that compare with electric vehicles?
It's very different because in an IC engine, you're controlling engine ECUs to try and cut power, or you're using brakes to try and limit the amount of power on a particular corner for either traction or stability control. With the electric motor, you're able to precisely demand exact amounts of torques and do that many times a second. We're talking of, you know, microsecond analysis going on and slip control being down to that level of control and torque to fractions of newton meters of torque being able to be exactly demanded, so the system can measure what the conditions are and very quickly with feedback control get really accurately, really precise control. And if you see our car do a launch and see it take off, I mean, many people were astounded at the speed that it takes off, and with no gearing, with just a single speed, we don't have to then also change gear multiple times. So it's 0 to 60 most cars do in one gear, but then beyond that they're having to change gear. When we push on and do things like quarter of a mile, we do the whole quarter of a mile without ever changing gear. In fact, we can go up to top speed with never changing gear. So great.
That's something interesting I just want to delve into, because again, for those from an IC background, obviously the gearbox is ingrained into our sort of expectations. So the torque and power delivery from an electric motor is quite unique in that the maximum torque occurs basically at stall or stationary, yep. And then the torque drops off. So can you just tell us how that power band works in terms of the torque and the power?
Well, the torque doesn't drop off for some time. We're quite a way up our speed and rev range before the torque even starts to drop off, but the power virtually doesn't drop off at all within any of the speed range that we operate within. So it's phenomenal. And that's one of the great feelings of driving an electric car. If we're driving an IC car, perhaps in traffic, and we see an opportunity or an overtaking opportunity, we have to either manually or automatically get downshift. That takes some time and effort to do it before we get that shift down, the torque available, and accelerating to the gap. With an electric car, you're able to take those opportunities far more quickly, and that's one of the things when you drive an electric car which is so noticeable, that instantaneous torque that's available throughout the entire speed and rev range.
Now, with that just one gear essentially, I'm assuming there you're going to have to make some compromise on the gearing for the vehicle in order to sort of balance the low RPM torque or low speed torque and your maximum desirable road speed?
Well, it's more of a balance between the speed and acceleration and the range of the car, because we obviously want to have a speed where the motor is operating in a really efficient mode when it's going at a normal driving speed, so that you get it really, the motor running at its most efficient mode at say 50 or 60 miles an hour, which we could say would be a typical driving speed. So you really want to optimize that range against the performance requirements, and that just takes a little bit of work and some calculations and some experimentation within the team, and we think we got that down to a good margin, because we've got astonishing acceleration figures that you've already talked about, and we've got a range of well over 300 miles, approaching 370, around 370 miles at the moment.
That definitely is impressive mileage, because that is another area where there's been a lot of sort of negative talk about the usefulness of electric vehicles.
Yes.
With their range. Now, just one more aspect while we've been talking about the power is one of the things we've been talking about here a lot at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb is the high altitude. We've got low barometric air pressure. We're getting to over 14,000 feet by the summit. So for a conventional IC engine, it's really, really hard. There's not a lot of oxygen in the air, so they're struggling to make the sort of power they make at sea level. And really, that's an area, the electric vehicle, doesn't suffer there?
Doesn't suffer at all there. Electrons flow just as quickly down the wires up at 14,000 feet as they do down here at 9,000 feet, the same as they would at sea level. It doesn't make any difference. So we get all our 1,000 and plus horsepower wherever we are. It can deliver that all the time.
Another area that we've seen some big developments in with electric vehicles, and I guess this may have been one of the limitations back in the earlier days, certainly still maybe to a degree a limitation, is the battery technology. Generally, they haven't had good mileage, as we've discussed. So how would you sort of put the level of technology we've got in batteries right now? Is that still something that's holding EV back? Are you looking forward to some improvements in that technology, and when can we see that in the future?
Batteries have improved enormously in the last 5-8 years. The technology has improved, the amount of energy we can cram into the same amount of space has improved dramatically, and the prices have plummeted, and that's going to be the big enabler for EV technology to expand more in the sort of everyday market, is to, when that battery price comes down and we're able to deliver cars at the sort of price range that the average person can expect. So the price is one thing, and the sort of energy density, the amount of energy we can get out of into a battery cell is getting better all the time. We're expecting over the next few years there'll be some further gains in that, maybe another 20% yet. And there's more chemistries and more technologies being yet developed, so there'll be further stages from where we are today. But even with what we've got today, as the price comes down, the technology slightly improves, and already having got 300, nearly 400 miles of range, we're at a point where we're virtually matching gasoline car range. You have to refuel one of those. The speed of recharging is getting faster and faster, and so it will soon be at a point where they're very similar. There's probably ultimately there'll be still a small difference, but after driving 300 miles, most of us want a little bit of a rest break. So, you know, what's 15 minutes, 20 minutes?
So that's the charge time at the moment, 15 to 20 minutes?
That's the sort of charge time we're sort of looking at people expecting. I mean, often charge time is talked about in miles per hour, which initially sounds strange, but when you think about it, it's how many miles you can get in a certain amount of time. And people like ourselves and Tesla, we're looking at speeds of sort of 300, 400, 500, 600 miles an hour. So if you want to try and get another 300 miles range in, you're talking of sort of half an hour maybe, and if you don't need quite that much, then quicker times. And those speeds are getting better all the time with improvements in charging technology.
So another technology that electric vehicles have that internal combustion engines miss out on is regenerative braking. So can you just talk us through briefly how that works?
Well, the advantage with the an electric motor is basically the same as a generator. So when you run it the opposite way, when you put energy back into it, it generates electricity. So what we're able to do with an EV is, when we, instead of having to use the mechanical brakes, in many circumstances, we can put use the motors to slow the vehicle down and put that energy back into the battery pack. And that's why, for instance, on our car, we have four-wheel drive, we have all motors connected, all wheels connected to the motors, so that we can recover energy from every wheel, so we put as much energy back into the battery pack at every opportunity that we can.
So this would be an advantage, particularly around town where you're doing a lot of start-stop and there's a lot of braking?
Yes, absolutely. So that's the point. You know, anything we can do to extend that range, any energy we can recover. And it's quite noticeable on cars like a Tesla, the brakes just don't wear out anywhere near so fast. They don't even have to go in for service so much, because the brakes last so much longer, because you're using that regenerative energy so much of the time that you often don't use the brakes at all.
Look, Nick, it's been really interesting getting some insight into the EV technology. As I said at the start, it's not something I know a huge amount about, but we know it is going to be a big part of our future. Yep. Maybe we're still going to have a few IC cars running around, but yeah, definitely I see more and more EV vehicles in our future. We look forward to following the development of the Faraday in beta at the moment and seeing it make its way into production. Thanks for the chat.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, good talking to you.